Good evening. Good evening. My name is Jeff McGee. I have the privilege to be the Dean of the Faculty of Engineering here. The Energy Futures Lab brings together researchers in energy across the college, a genuinely multidisciplinary initiative and effort by the Institute. However, it is hosted by the Faculty of Engineering, and so in February 2014, it was my privilege to appoint Professor Tim Green as the new director of the Energy Futures Lab Institute. He takes over from Nigel Brandon, who now heads our Sustainable Gas Institute. Before I go any further, I've been reminded to ask you to tell you that this lecture will be videotaped, and so you should be on your best behavior. Okay. I was very impressed that before Tim agreed to take on directorship, he thought very carefully about what his contribution, his unique contribution, could be to the Institute, and I think that that's what we will hear tonight, so no pressure there, Tim. A little bit of background about Tim. He did his BSc here at Imperial College in Electrical Engineering before going on to do a PhD at Heriot Watt. And following his PhD at Heriot Watt, he stayed on there for a few years as a lecturer before we managed to persuade him to come back here to Imperial College, where he has been ever since. Tim is now a professor in the Department of Electrical Engineering and also deputy head. Tim's research is concerned with the design of electricity networks to support low-carbon futures. A particular theme is related to harnessing the flexibility of power electronics and control in the emerging smart grid to accommodate new generation patterns of new forms of load. For example, electric vehicle charging. Tim's also interested in offshore DC networks and the management of low voltage networks. He leads the HubNet consortium of 8 UK universities, coordinating research in low carbon energy, and is a network champion of Research Councils UK. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is my very great pleasure to invite Tim to give his lecture on being smart with energy. Tim, thank you.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Thank you for the warm welcome. It is indeed my great pleasure to give this lecture, to introduce myself as Director of the Energy Futures Lab, and to say something about my own research interests, but try to meld that into what I see as some of the key challenges and opportunities facing the Energy Futures Lab. And I'm going to try also to say a little bit about what makes me tick and what drew me to engineering in the first place and then to this particular role. So quite a lot of ground to cover in 45 minutes or so I should crack on. I should press the right button also. I saw this on a wall of a building recently, and I thought this was quite a nice way to start off, because I am at heart an engineer. I'm not a scientist who accidentally found himself in an engineering department, I don't think, because what I like to do is to use science to problem solve and to create, and then to build things and see if they work, and I think that defines me as an engineer. But it's recognising through that the central role of science as the underpinning discipline of that, and bringing scientific rigour to that process. And touching on that also in terms of the innovation process and how ideas get into commercial acceptance. And all of those are the sorts of things that the Energy Futures Lab needs to address. So this particular photograph I took while visiting this thing. This is what I do on the weekend, is find things that me and my boy can do visiting things in London. I've never visited Tower Bridge because it's not perhaps my favourite bridge, because I know underneath all of that Gothic stonework is a steel structure. It's a little bit of a fabrication, really, or it is a fabrication. But it was worth a visit, and it's worth a visit for me because it has one of these things in it, which is the thing that I really love. So old steam engines is one of the things that give me pleasure. The poetry motion, literally, of these things and the way they work. I think the elegance of these devices is appealing, and these things trace engineering history. There is the central governor that was the very first application of feedback control systems. And I love the care with which these things have been built. All of these moving bearings and sliding parts needed lubrication systems, and there's these lovely little glass jars on each of them filled with oil with these beautiful turned brass caps on them. And the attention to detail in there, I think, is fascinating. So this I see as the art of engineering. Some appreciation of art as well. I'm not an art historian or an art specialist. So earlier in the summer, though, I did visit the fantastic Turner exhibition in National Maritime Museum, which is all about Turner and the sea. This is a Turner, as many of you would recognise. It's obviously not about the sea. But I found this particular painting fascinating because it marks a point in time, really. This is towards the end of Turner's career, but it's towards the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. And it's a mark of his fascination with what was happening around him at this point in time. This is one of the Great Western Railway locomotives crossing the Thames on the bridge at Maidenhead. And it puts me in mind of just what was happening in the middle of the 19th century and the fantastic and inspiring people that existed at that point in time. So this was Turner recognising what was happening in the industrial environment around him, and in particular what Brunel was doing to produce a high-speed, for those days, transport system between Bristol and London. And Brunel kind of echoing that and recognising the importance of art and form and function coming together in his work. So Brunel had this fantastic vision of how you get quickly between Bristol and London, which was to build a railway which was as flat as you possibly could. And he did the civil engineering of that. He used that imperative as the design constraints on the bridges and the tunnels and the structures that he built. But he did it with great panache as well, a fantastic building at Paddington, and then the fabulous attention to detail along the way, the chimneys of water pumping stations along the way disguised to look like the bell towers of the town of churches, and that echoing back, Turner recognising the art and the science and him recognising art as well. Brunel was an inspiring figure. He couldn't do quite everything. He covered an enormous range of topics, and we talked today about interdisciplinary working. These people did interdisciplinary working without really knowing that was a term to pay attention to. They just had a vision of what they wanted to achieve and then set out to solve all the problems that needed to be solved to meet that vision. Brunel was skilled as a civil engineer and as a constructor. He had to rely on this chap, Daniel Gooch, to design his locomotives because he had a particular weak spot for designing locomotives. And that makes Daniel Gooch sound like a minor figure in comparison to Brunel. He did one aspect of the railway engineering. In fact, when you look into the history of Gooch not only designed those engines, but he also was instrumental in laying the first transatlantic communications cables, signals cables, and found time to be an MP alongside all of those duties. And Kirchhoff, as someone who set down the founding principles of electric circuit theory, also driven to look at spectroscopy and black body radiation. So these are people really who didn't think about discipline boundaries. They pursued the things that interested them, and they pursued the things that were in the way of them achieving their overall goal. Brunel was famous for producing some fantastic bridges, and it seems to me he never produced two bridges that look quite the same. Ones like this one, the Royal Albert Bridge, are particularly eye-catching. This is the one that Turner painted, the bridge across the Thames at Maidenhead, and I mention this one because it shows how Brunel's vision led through to the technological challenges of the day that he had to produce. He wanted a railway as flat as he could between Bristol and London, because locomotives at the time were not very good at climbing hills and keeping up speed. But he wanted to cross that river with only two arches. So that said, he needed very low arches and very long arches. And that gives rise to that very graceful shape there. And that's the form and function coming together in perfect harmony, I think. People at the time said, a brick-built arch as shallow as that was never going to stay up. Well, they were wrong, of course, because it's still there 150 years later. But I think the mark of the man was the directors at the time got very worried that that might possibly be true, that brick arch was not going to be strong enough. And they insisted that when the bridge was inaugurated, that the wooden trusses that had supported that bridge during construction were kept in place. Because that outraged Brunel, who knew very well that bridge wasn't coming down. So he instructed his contractors just to drop those wooden trusses a couple of inches. So at a distance, it looked like they still supported the arches, but in fact, he knew full well they didn't. And then he drove his engine over it with the directors in the carriage behind him. You know, you imagine what was going through his mind at the time. That's the engine that did it. Well, actually, strictly, it's a replica in the National Railway Museum, an engine called North Star. That one actually designed by Stephenson. And I only drop that in. For those of you who've sat in the Research Council's headquarters in Swindon and wondered why the astronomers got to name that Polaris house on North Star Avenue, they didn't. It's named for the engineering that happened in the Great Western Railway at Swindon. It's named after that one. So, I would like to go on for another 40 minutes or so on great railway engineers, but I shan't. I'm going to pick on another visionary engineer who is very much less well known, but probably should be much better known, and that's Sebastian de Ferranti. The picture is a picture of the Grosvenor Gallery in New Bond Street that was owned by Sir Coutts Lindsay, and in the late 1880s, he decided to light his gallery with the new smokeless electric lights. And it was a very popular thing to do, and his neighbours in the West End, in the galleries and the hotels and the theatres, thought this was a fantastic idea, and asked if they could run a couple of lights off the generators that he had in his basement. And he realised he had a business on his hands here, propagating electric lighting around the West End of London, and he appointed Sebastian de Ferranti to be the chief engineer of the London Electric Supply Company when he was just 24 years old. So his task was to turn that into a business, both in engineering terms and in commercial terms. He realised he needed much bigger generators. They weren't going to fit in the basement of that gallery. And building a large power station in the middle of Mayfair was not going to work, not just because it cost a lot of money to buy the land, but because you couldn't get enough horse and cars through central London for the coal. So he knew he needed to build his power station in Deptford, where the land was cheap and you could get a coal barge up the Thames easily, and you could build a big structure like that, and that's what he did. But he also knew that there's 800 kilowatt generators in there generating at about 1,000 volts, and therefore about 800 amps, wouldn't supply 800 amps through a cable all the way from Deptford to the West End without burning a lot of the power in losses in the cable and dropping volts. So he knew he had to push the volts up. He had to get the volts up to about 10,000 volts. And if he had to do that, he had to use a transformer. And if he had to do that, he had to have an AC system. And while Westinghouse and Edison in the United States were bickering about whether AC or DC was the right way to go, Ferranti saw that locational arbitrage was important. He needed to produce the energy cheaply in Deptford and sell it at a premium in Mayfair. And that led him through a chain of logic to saying the system had to be AC. And then he had a whole set of engineering challenges to solve. There were no cables capable of running at 10,000 volts, so he had to design his own cables, his own systems of feeders and laterals off them, and ways of protecting the system against faults in the cables. And he designed that electricity system top to bottom, and it is recognisably what we do today. And I think he was an example of a visionary who drove that vision through a chain of logic to engineering decisions, and then went and sought the technologies he needed to make that a reality. Of course, then people realised that there was a lot more you could do with electricity, and this is the Edison Electric Company in the United States advertising to people to encourage them to use electricity for other things, for vacuum cleaners and electric irons and so forth. And it seems extraordinary now that you had to tell people all the other things you could do with electricity. Some advertising campaigns were possibly slightly well focused on others. And we know we were successful in growing electricity as a means to grow our industry. We powered industry in developed countries through the second half of the 20th century. Of course, we now know what the consequence of that was. We've been burning a lot of fossil fuels in the electricity industry and transport and so forth. And we're now at a point where we're putting 30-something gigatons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. And that's led us to the next phase, if you like, of concern over energy systems. We had the experimentation and the definition of the system in the tail end of the 19th century. We have the expansion into the other uses of energy in the early part of the 20th century. We have the driving of industry, and the electricity system tried to just keep up with economic growth. And now we've got the concern of climate change. course, we know, many of you will be familiar with this graph from the IPCC pathways, that if we carry on letting our economic growth drive carbon emissions, we get up to very scary numbers about total CO2 emissions and scary numbers about potential rises in global average temperatures. If we want to hold even to something like 2.5 degrees, roughly speaking, of temperature rise, we have to take our 32 gigatons of carbon and reduce to around half of that by the end of the century. And that, of course, is an enormous challenge, as you well know, I'm sure. And one way of unpicking that and looking at what you've got to do is the K identity, and it says that total emissions are related to how many people there are in the world, how much GDP is produced per person, how much economic activity, how much energy one uses to produce each unit of GDP, and how much CO2 emission you get from each unit of energy. And if you just think about what would happen naturally, out to 2050, we're probably going to hit something like a 30% increase in global population. If we grow at a sensible rate worldwide, we're probably going to end up in an economy that's 2 to 2.5 times bigger than it presently is. And we've been making some modest progress in energy intensity, the energy per unit GDP, so it's falling slightly. And you end up with a calculation like this that says out of 2050 we'd be putting 1.7 times as much CO2 into the atmosphere as at present. To get down to something like half as much CO2, we've got to have some really radical reductions in these last two factors, in the energy intensity of GDP and the carbon intensity of CO2. And that's really what the Energy Futures Lab needs to set out to do as its part of contribution to climate change concern. And the thrill for me, the reason for being so keen to take on the role of leading the Energy Futures Lab, is the fabulous range of technology that a university like Imperial has at its disposal to meet some of these challenges. There are many universities around the country and around the world who will be active in some of these areas. But to be acting in all of these areas is a fantastic opportunity for us as a college. You know, a great range of technologies that are being researched in sustainable power, complemented with research on carbon capture and clean fossil fuel use, so that we continue to use fossil fuels as a bridging technology. On the carbon intensity side, transport is a major user of energy, clearly, and we have work in many departments around the college looking at future drivetrains for land vehicles, for aircraft or for ships, but also some fantastic work modelling how transport choices are made by people and how transport as a whole in a city is organised. And then work on energy infrastructure, those of us working in electricity networks but also in other energy vectors, and on energy storage, a large activity now grown in energy storage, thankfully to the leadership of Nigel and others in the Energy Futures Lab in recent years. And of course, importantly, energy efficiency, and our contribution to that is larger energy efficiency in the process. And that isn't sufficient, because if we can't turn that into successful innovation in the commercial environment, we haven't done our job. And if we can't have influence, rightly so, you know, in terms of scientific input to government policy, we haven't done our job. So this, at the bottom, is at least as important as the rest. For me, this is the starting point of the chain of logic for what I do. Europe is lucky, really. Europe has a wide variety of renewable energy sources, and the UK in particular, great access to offshore wind in relatively shallow seas out in the North Sea. Tidal races around Orkney and in other places, giving us access to marine energy. The nice thing about looking at this on a European scale is the ability to say that even if wind speeds are quite low at a particular point in time across the UK, we may have significant wind down in the Iberian Peninsula, or we've got solar photovoltaics maybe in southern Europe, and access to hydro in the Alps and in Scandinavia. And a key feature of this is the blending of those renewable energy sources. By accessing diversity between technologies and diversity on a continental scale, we get a portfolio of renewable energy that is more useful and more usable for us in our economy. the logic of that is, if we're going to rely on this portfolio mix, is being able to move energy across Europe on that sort of scale, on gigawatts and tens of gigawatts scale, which means for the UK, building out into the North Sea to access the big wind farms at Dogger Bank and Hornsea and so forth, but also building out links to Norway for the access to the hydro and to the Low Countries and to Germany, so that we can trade our wind when it's plentiful and we can import photovoltaic energy or others at other times. To do that, we've got to lay big cables across the North Sea. I'm just going to light on that picture down the bottom. That is a bit of cable that you can go and see in Amberley Working Museum. That's a bit of Ferranti's original 10 kV cable. He set the shape of cable to come, really. This is just an engineering elaboration of that original idea. That was copper conductor and waxed paper insulator in the 1890s. And this is cross-linked polyethylene doing the same job now. These things are good for 1,000 to 2,000 amps. And now pushed up to about 500 kV, so somewhat beyond those ratings. But the other interesting connection back to Ferranti is he had a compelling logic to run that thing on AC. We now have a compelling logic for this particular instance to subvert that and say we've got to do that on DC. Because in building this structure, we didn't mean to, but we've created ourselves a capacitor because we've got a conductor covered in a dielectric, and then interface to another conductor. So that metal dielectric metal structure is a capacitor, and if we run it on AC, then we have to charge up and discharge that capacitor through each cycle. And the longer you bend that cable, the bigger the capacitance and the bigger the capacitive currents that flow, and the lesser the current carrying capability of that thing is given over to actually shipping power. So somewhere around 50 to 60 kilometers of cable length, it's no longer really sensible to run that on AC and you run it on DC. Converting 1,000 megawatts of power between AC and DC is a big undertaking, and big sheds full of equipment to do it. The reason is you've got big standoff distances for the voltages, but also you need a large number of semiconductor devices to do the power conversion. Each semiconductor maybe you can run at something like 2,000 volts. If you're trying to get up to 500,000 volts, you need a lot of them together in series connections in the circuits to do it. This is a little cartoon nicked off Wikipedia, I'm sorry to say, of roughly how you do this. Sets of semiconductor switches in chains, illustrated here with about 8, but you'd have several hundred in the real thing, each with a capacitor holding a fraction of the DC voltage, and by switching them up and down here in sequence, you can synthesize something that looks a bit like a sine wave. By the time you've got a few hundred of those, you've got a very good sine wave synthesized from an original DC. So that's a technique that's reasonably well known now. We work on elaborations of that with Alstom. The real systems are about 1,000 megawatts. Alstom's demonstrator in their lab is built at 20 megawatts and is big enough. Our demonstrator in our lab is about a few kilowatts and somewhat smaller. We don't get to do this in SW7. And whereas theirs is made out of cells that are about a metre and a half long, ours are a couple of centimetres. But it enables us to test some of the ideas that we've been pursuing. Particularly, how do you minimise the size of that great big blue capacitor there? Because size minimisation is going to matter to drive down the size of the equipment for offshore platforms. We need to make these systems robust to short circuits on the AC side and the DC side that happen in the networks, and we've got some ideas about innovation in the circuit topology to do that. We've got thousands and thousands of individual capacitors for energy balance, so innovation in the control system to do that. And much of the electricity system has been built on an assumption that equipment's got a short-term rating, that a 100-megawatt transformer can run at 150 megawatts for 15, 30 minutes without it overheating very much. And we use that to get us through some emergency conditions. These semiconductor devices just don't behave like that. They don't have short-term ratings in those ways, so we're having to be innovative about the way we get short-term ratings out of these structures. And then we've got to go and do that. We've got to take that complicated bit of electronics and stick it in a big box and jack it up in the middle of the North Sea, as if that wasn't challenging enough already. So we think, as a group of academics working in the power area, there's six of us in electrical engineering in roughly this area, that we cover this sort of thing, circuit operation and optimization, some dynamic control of that, a bit of fault tolerance, moving more into what my colleagues do, the interactions between AC systems and DC systems and how you control those continental scale electricity systems, and at the top of that, the sort of stuff you do to plan, just how much of this do you want to build across years. So it's pitiful, really, as an example of interdisciplinary research. We think it's interdisciplinary because it covers all this stuff, but it's just a little bit of electrical engineering. Of course, there's quite a lot more that around the college we can be doing. We do work with our colleagues in the business school and the Centre for Environmental Policy to look at resource modelling across Europe, market design and the policy instruments that would drive some of these things to completion. Really got to start making these connections to how offshore structures and how you drive cost out and optimize the reliability with offshore structures impacts the electrical design, the oceanography of where you put your cables and how that impacts their reliability, and how these systems interact with the wind turbines out in the middle of the North Sea. Need to do more of this. But even that is a pretty modest set of interdisciplinary interactions if we're talking about the whole of the energy system and about being smart about energy as a whole. So time to move on from what I do to a broader piece about smarter energy. Like all rogues, I threw the key term into Google to see what Google would come back with. So I threw smart grid into Google and looked particularly at Google images. And two things leap off the page for me when you do that. The first is, these are all conceptual pictures about what a smart grid might be. They're not pictures about smart grids out there and operating. That's a bit disappointing. And the other thing you learn is, it seems that the smart grid is a circle. Whatever. So we didn't maybe learn an awful lot from Google. What a surprise. Many ways of defining smart grids, and in fact the problem is not a shortage of definition of smart grids, but maybe too many definitions of smart grids. One take on this follows from this graph. This is a graph of energy consumption and wind production in Ireland for a particular month back in 2011. You can see the day-night cycles of electricity demand very clearly, and then you can pick out the two weekend days and the five weekdays. And we've got very good at predicting those patterns, and through a market arrangement, we can ensure that the right generators are available to meet that, and we can meet our modelling error by scheduling some reserve, and we're quite good at knowing how much reserve to hold to account for unexpected things happening. We can even account for this over here, which looks like the people of Ireland took a four-day weekend when we realised that was Easter weekend. So we've got to see that one coming as well. What's harder now is that this wind input is essentially a zero marginal cost input to the system, so we're going to take it. And our job now is not just to predict what's happening to demand, but to think about what's happening to this input to the system, and our conventional generation fleet has to make up that difference. And it's how you do that in future, and how you do that at a sensible cost and in a secure way in order to accommodate this renewable energy. That is one of the drivers for being smart about energy. The various ways you can close that gap between demand and the wind input is to do the traditional things, like having lots of flexible generation like gas turbines. So we might, in a wind-rich system, have many more gas turbines sitting there in reserve or on standby waiting to come in. We've touched on this one, although maybe not overhead lines looking quite like that ordinarily. Build more infrastructure to connect the nations of Europe and to do some sharing of renewable energy resources, or to put storage devices in, grid-scale energy storage, a big feature of research work in Imperial, or rely on fridges, strangely enough. Sensibly, really, to rely or to look for flexibility in some sorts of appliances on the demand side, where we can manipulate demand a bit in order to match our system, balance our system. This is a graph that Goran likes to use, and I'm borrowing it, sorry, Goran. But some of these things, like relying on lots of reserve generation and building new infrastructure, means we're building infrastructure or using infrastructure for a few hundred hours of a year to support some of the extreme cases. And what that does is drive down the asset utilization, which has cost implications. So if we're looking at our energy trilemma of sustainability and affordability and security, this is not doing us any favours on affordability. But if we start using devices that already exist and using them in more imaginative ways, on the demand side or possibly storage, then we can keep our asset utilization up and keep our costs under some sort of control. We might be going after fridges, but that means communicating with many millions of fridges around the country. We're probably going to go after some of the larger future uses of electrical energy, such as electric vehicles and heat pumps for building heating, because both of these have a degree of discretion. We have some discretion over where and when we charge the vehicles, and we have some discretion because of the big thermal lag in buildings of when we heat and we cool our buildings. So those look like the opportunities to go after, but still we're talking about trying to now talk to very large numbers of energy consumers and influence their behavior. This is the prize, really, is to be able to take some electric vehicle charging and fill in troughs, which improves our asset utilization, but take some of the electric vehicle charging and put it here, sort of paradoxically, at the peak of the energy demand, if that happens to coincide with a very windy day with the wind available at the peak. So we'll try to make some of our loads, the discretionary loads like electric vehicle charging, follow to where the availability of the energy is. So at the moment, National Grid controls its system through a control room like this in Wokingham. 200 or so generator sets to worry about, maybe 10 to 15 of those being actively controlled to control the system and the rest following the market positions. So National Grid needs to talk to a relatively small number of generators and some of its own equipment in terms of assets in the network. It's not set up, as we configured at the moment, to talk to many thousands, hundreds of thousands of millions of individual consumers to try to influence their behavior. So the future does look like a much more intricate communication layer, talking to all sorts of things and people around the country in order for us to be smart about energy. And many people are doing work like this, looking at how maybe if you fed a house with a home automation system, day-ahead price signal, your home automation system could start scheduling some of the activities which are flexible in terms of their timing, about choosing when to heat the building and when to run certain appliances. Of course, doing this, setting a price that calls up the right demand-side action is not a trivial matter. It means understanding the elasticities of demand in our system and discovering how elastic certain demands are will be a big part of how the system works. There's some very clever work going on in our group at the moment about how you find the elasticity of the demand and how you express that and how you come up with day-ahead prices to get the behavior you want. Devices, no, home automation is something which has been talked about for a long time and maybe was always seemed futuristic at one point and then fanciful and a bit silly at later points. But things are beginning to move, we can see. So Nest started producing these thermostats that learn what you want to do with the heating of your home. So rather than you just setting a time in the early morning when your heating comes on and another time at which it clicks off, and you set that rather conservatively because you don't want to be cold, you interact with it and adjust the temperatures and it learns when it is you want your house to be at certain temperatures. And if it interacts with other things in the house, starts to learn about when you're home and when you're not and what your habits are. Google paid an extraordinary amount of money to buy that company, more money than it paid to buy YouTube. And that's a wake-up call, isn't it? When Google get interested in thermostats in houses, something very interesting is happening in our energy system. And it's scared Honeywell, because Honeywell are now busy doing something similar, and GE and Philips are doing clever things with apps on phones to control the lighting in your house, and various startup companies doing home automation systems. That home automation startup company has now been bought by Nest Google. So things are moving, when it didn't look like they were some years ago. And there's an amazing amount of stuff happening in other fields, which the energy system now needs to copy. We have, as I mentioned earlier, fantastic work at Imperial on modelling transport choices that people make and understanding modes of transport that are used and work on how buildings use energy and how we can get smarter about that. We know that supermarkets are sophisticated in knowing what they should stock depending on the weather, what's on the television, how that changes city by city and how that changes across a city. Quite disaggregated models of what consumers do. And telecoms companies are very good at predicting telecom traffic. When there's a football match, they know what that means in terms of the additional telecoms traffic that will happen in that area. Particularly if one of the teams playing, it's as important for their supporters to know if a rival team somewhere else is losing will influence just how much video on demand might be happening across people's phones. So sophisticated modelling of consumers is happening in telecoms and in retail and in transport and in various sectors. And we have to get cute about accessing that and not just being good at predicting how a national population as a whole consume energy, but breaking it down into how different regions and different types of people behave and what that means about their flexibility. It used to be that the big spikes and oddities in electricity demand curves, like this blue one here, were all about what was called TV pickup. A television program ends, like EastEnders, and everybody goes off to make a cup of coffee or tea, puts the kettle on, opens the fridge door. All of this adds to electricity demand, uses the loo, adds to the sewage pumping load, which is significant, and you get these spikes called TV pickup. Of course, people's habits have changed. You don't all sit down together to watch TV programs at the same time because people time shift their viewing habits. So the strange events are now the one-offs. So this apparently was fascinating to some people. The marriage of William and Kate a few years ago. Look at these extraordinary changes in demand. 2.3 gigawatt of demand increase as they exit the Abbey. 3.1 gigawatt of demand decrease just because someone's kissing on the balcony. How the heck would you predict that? Well, actually, there's some very clever work, not on this topic, but elsewhere in Imperial, in the mathematics department, looking at large data sets coming from social media. People tweet all sorts of things about television programs and their habits and what they're up to. And you could monitor social media activity, and you could probably get a pretty good correlation with some of these events. And we have to get smart about doing things like that. So it is about engaging with smart customers. It is about engaging with smart buildings and smart transport systems, and we build out from that to smart ways to operate our grid, and we build out from that to smart ways to run our energy system as a whole. And it is, in large measure, about accessing data, processing large data sets, extracting the valuable information about that, about what people are trying to do with the services they want to use, and then what that tells us about the energy we need to provide and about the flexibility there may be and the ways in which we might influence where and when that energy demand pops up. This picture you might recognise, because you might recognise that building just about. This is Rochester in New York State, but that's the Kodak building. And we just dropped this one in as a reminder that many of these innovative changes in various sectors are not driven through by the incumbents. Kodak knew its business of selling film and chemical processing of film to produce prints was a waning business activity, and it tried very hard to diversify. It was one of the first companies to look at digital photography and tried to make a business out of digital cameras and out of digital photo frames and all of those things. But it couldn't adapt successfully, because it didn't see the other things were happening, that in fact even digital cameras at the consumer end were going, because people were using mobile phones as their camera. And so this is just a warning, because Kodak's share price collapsed and the company is just about crawling out of Chapter 11 protection now. Its business went away because it was the incumbent and it couldn't adapt to major change in its business sector. And when Google starts buying thermostat companies, albeit smart thermostat companies, something is moving. And maybe even Google doesn't know quite where all of that is going, but it wants to be in that smart energy sector so that it can find where it makes its business. At the moment it's shipping lots of those thermostats because you can pay 180 quid for those things and you can take something off your energy bill that will pay back. But I can't believe Google thinks its ultimate market there is in shipping smart thermostats at 180 quid a time. Something else is in prospect. So that's a bit about consumers and how consumers like to use services and what that means for energy. People do get, from time to time, engaged with the other side of this. Where does their energy come from? And it crops up in the media when, mostly when there's a community taken against a local energy project. So plenty of examples of people taken against onshore wind turbines and it getting picked up by politicians, and we have seen in recent years quite a shift in the planning, the way the planning rules are used by local government and central government, and stalling in that. This is closer to me physically. This is the protest in Bolton because of this drill, test drill for shale gas. I live about 500 metres up the road from where all that was happening, as some of you might know. So a lot of agitation and deep public concern about what fracking might mean in terms of local pollution, but also climate change. The thing for me that came out of this was this group of people, not an anti-fracking group, this is Repower Bolcom. This is a community energy project, a co-op in the making, trying to define themselves not in terms of what they're against, but what they're in favour of. Trying to find renewable energy resources around the area that could be sold back to the community through a co-op arrangement. And in other parts of the country, this is working, looking for low-quality arable land that might be put over to this, or big farm buildings or commercial buildings in which this could happen. And this is a reconnection with people, between people and where their energy comes from. And I think that's tremendously interesting. Because once you start to think about can you power your community on photovoltaics, you immediately hit the problem of what you do on dark winter evenings. And you have to think about where else your energy has come from. So you might go into it thinking that photovoltaics might be the answer to your local problem, but it engages people immediately with the rest of the energy debate. Where do we source our energy from? If you're going to say no to wind turbines, what are you going to say yes to? Frankly, it's a bit of a struggle in the UK. Germany has done this much better. About half of their renewable energy portfolio is community-owned, and the community and cooperative schemes are taking off. And there's a lot for us to learn about, first, how you promote this as a means to re-engage people with a debate about where their energy comes from and look for solutions that are acceptable to local communities. I want to make a passing mention of this chap and something he said to us last week. So this is Katsu Hiroshi, who is a senior engineer with Toyota, and he came and gave a lecture for the Energy Futures Lab last week. He had a vision many years ago about making engines and vehicles run much more fuel efficiently by keeping them closer to that part of their torque speed characteristic where they run efficiently. And the outcome of that was the synergy hybrid drive, where you hybridize a conventional engine, much smaller than in a normal vehicle, with a motor and a generator. He talked about the trials and tribulations of taking that through a development phase and then into a commercial phase, and it now is selling 7 million vehicles. But the point he made at the end of his talk was hybridizing that thing was achievable only when you'd hybridized the people. He liked that phrase about hybridizing people. And that's what the Energy Futures Lab is about. We have fantastic talent around the college in engineering and science and in innovation and policy. Researchers working in many different fields. Imperial College has to be more than the sum of its parts in the energy field. And it's bringing people together and hybridizing that expertise is what the Energy Futures Lab exists to do. We're running all sorts of events. This was a discussion of the fracking issue with a panel to discuss that and a lively debate. We've held workshops around the shale gas issue because there are legitimate concerns about water use and water contamination in the flowback from those wells and about fugitive emissions of methane. And all of those are engineering and science issues on which we can have opinions. And can provide evidence. Is there a real problem with fugitive emissions? Is there a real problem with water resource use? And if there are, what solutions can be brought, or what technology can be brought to bear to progress on those issues? But also to think about this in terms of energy use overall. is shale gas a short-term bridging fuel, or do we need to be looking at carbon capture technologies added to this so that it becomes a low carbon technology as well? So our job is to run events that hybridise the people we've got and bring together those talents, and then when we have identified a challenge, a vision for what we want to do, to pursue that with the research councils or other funders as appropriate. So to kind of loop back to some of the places where I started, I'm fascinated by some of those great figures of the 19th century, the vision they had, the chain of logic they followed from that vision to what engineering decisions they had to make, and what technologies and sciences that called up that they had to explore. And they were unafraid of the boundaries, because they didn't even know the boundaries existed around the disciplines. I'm not sure that that's the model that works into the future. We have sophisticated technologies across such a wide range of topics that having a single person able to drive through a vision across all of that is now looking unlikely. But it is about bringing together teams of people, and I am very lucky to have some fantastic people to work with, fantastic individuals, but also a fantastic group of people who talk to each other regularly and cooperate, and that team spirit is something that I'm delighted to see in the group that we have. But it's not just about putting our teams together, it's about thinking about customers and how they like to use products and services. It's about engaging with people and their views of what energy sources they want to use. And another comment I want to pick up off of someone who came to talk to us recently, Andy Whitemore from Rio Tinto, came in and gave a fascinating talk. And one of his concluding remarks was, it's very easy to talk to these people about what they're pro about renewable energy schemes and how to implement them at community level. You don't make huge amounts of progress by doing that. The real challenge is to talk to people who have challenging views and to try to explain to them what the options are and to challenge some of their perceptions about what's happening. And bringing all of that together and bringing all of that to bear on the energy debate is what we're about. So, back to the other thing I love, which is old steam engines. It feels a bit like this. It feels a bit like now, as director of the Energy Futures Lab, I'm in charge of this enormous machine, which is the Energy Research at Imperial. In charge of is maybe not quite the phrase I should have chosen. Having an oversight and an ambition to join up all of this. It's a machine that's hurtling forward at tremendous velocity because of all the activity we have. And it's a thrilling ride, if a slightly scary ride. Those of you who know something about driving steam trains, the driving of it is the glamorous bit, but actually the technical bit and the most challenging bit is how you keep the boiler pressure up and the boiler full of water and keep the fire running. And what goes on in the footplate with the rest of the team is important. So I'm delighted and relieved to have a fantastic team of co-directors for the Energy Futures Lab and a brilliant operations team to support me. So I want to just close by saying I hope many of you are going to come on this journey of smart energy. I think there's a fantastic opportunity around Imperial College to bring to bear data analytics and smart buildings and smart transport systems to bear on energy systems and to help us decarbonise and make efficient our energy system. So, thank you very much.
Tim has kindly agreed to take some questions. Since we are recording the lecture, if you would give your name and affiliation before asking your question. So with that, do we have any questions? At the back.
Renewable energy Europe.
Well, some of the early stages of that are there, certainly. So many of the countries on continental Europe are interconnected to an extent. That was historical and for kind of a sharing of technical services across that. But many of the links have been strengthened between Spain and France, new links going in for the UK between the UK and the Netherlands, a second link to France, and further links to Belgium. It's progressing. These are very capital-intensive projects and costly projects. I think the issues really are about what are we going to do out in the North Sea? Are we going to simply run lines out to connect to the wind farms that we project, or are we going to be bolder about that in terms of onwards connections to Norway? And are we going to build an integrated grid across the North Sea, or are we going to be a bit more parochial about it and just connect up our wind farms? So I think some of the signs are there that we're doing that. There certainly is a prize to be had. There's a lot more to do. So energy, you will sometimes hear people say that we don't have a means to store electrical energy. We have had historically pumped storage schemes. We do have means to store electrical energy in electrochemical process, in batteries and flow batteries, and in compressed air systems. And there are several candidate technologies there. The question is really, can we do it in a cost-effective way that competes with successfully against the traditional ways of managing electricity systems? I think electricity systems would use storage if storage was a more cost-effective option than holding plant on reserve. So there is a huge effort. I mean, there's an effort, my colleague Goran was in the audience, looking at when you plan that European network, how much less of that you need to build if you make certain assumptions about the cost of storage. And research projects on grid-scale energy storage are led from Imperial and going involving other UK universities, trying to say that instead of expressing technology targets for storage in terms of things like kilowatt hours per kilogram, which has been a traditional metric for how good a storage element is, can you express it now in kilowatt hours per pound? How can you drive down, through technology advancement, the cost of storage and build it big enough to be effective at grid scale?
Hi, Zan, I'm at the Imperial Business School. Curious about your thoughts on the hydrogen economy. Do you think you didn't really touch much on hydrogen during the presentation? That's definitely one vision for the future. Just wanted to hear your thoughts.
That says a lot about. So there's hydrogen has been postulated, and it was popular some years ago as an alternative energy vector to electricity. I think some of the calculations that you run on that make that look not as attractive as I first thought, principally about how do you convert the hydrogen back to an ordered form of energy. That step is always going to be far from ideally efficient. But I think using hydrogen as a means to enrich the gas network or to find a future use for the gas network is interesting. Solar routes to hydrogen and then using that as a future fuel is interesting. And possibly at times of large inputs of renewable energy for which you don't have another use, conceivably electrolyzing that and using that in the gas network. I didn't touch on, you're right, because it's not really my area of expertise, the future use of the gas network and the interactions between the future gas network and the future electricity network. That are the sorts of multi-energy vector studies are part of what does happen at Imperial.
And with that, I'd like to ask Professor Eric Gateman, also the Department of Electrical Engineering, to propose a vote of thanks. Eric.
Thank you very much. As Jeff said, I'm Eric Gateman. I'm Deputy Head of Electrical Engineering, one of, and in fact, the person you just heard from is the other. It's my privilege to give this vote of thanks, and also it's been my privilege to be Tim's colleague for, I guess, what is more or less exactly 20 years now, since he joined the department back in 1994. At that time, we did have a power and energy activity, but it was somewhat in decline. The incumbent staff were at or near retirement age, and there was a feeling and a possibility, indeed, that activity was going to die out completely at Imperial. I think it's no exaggeration to say that Tim, and later joined by a number of excellent colleagues, some of which are here with us, turned that around completely and took something from near extinction to what has become one of the most important and most successful activities, certainly in our department, and also one of the leading energy activities both in the country and I think in the broader world. But let's say a little bit about the lecture itself. Tim took us on a journey at the beginning of some of the historical people and achievements that have inspired him, and showed us a little bit about how engineering can have elegance and even beauty and not just utility, and I think that was terrific to see. Then we looked at some of the challenges facing us that I think we're all to some extent familiar with, about decarbonizing energy and decarbonizing our economy to face the challenges of climate change. And we saw the national, international scope of those challenges and how the solutions also have to have an international scope. And we looked at component parts of those challenges from a European-wide electricity grid, incorporating renewables, to electricity on the level of your own home, and how home automation and dynamic pricing can have effects on solving those challenges. We even saw how you can reduce energy demand in the country by a gigawatt, I think it was, merely by kissing a princess, so there's one for you all to take home with you. If you get that opportunity. I'm sure, like me, you've been left with a much clearer idea of not only what the challenges are, but some of the ways that we can solve them, and also how Tim and his Energy Futures Lab and all his colleagues in it, and the hybridization of people that's going to happen in that lab, can help us solve those challenges. I think, like me, you've been left with some excitement and optimism about our ability as scientists and engineers, and I know a lot of you in the room are engaged in these challenges, can really be successful in meeting what we need to solve these problems for society, but also some of the fun we can have in getting there. I'd like you to join me once again in thanking Professor Tim Green for an excellent introductory lecture as director of the Energy Futures Lab.